Hello and welcome. You're watching NDTV 24/7. I'm Priyanshi Sharma, and our lead story this hour: two new union ministers now have additional portfolios after two ministers resigned. Women and Child Development Minister Smriti Irani has been given the additional charge of the Ministry of Minority Affairs, while Civil Aviation Minister Jyotiraditya Scindia has been given the additional charge of the Ministry of Steel. This as two union ministers, Mukhtar Abbas Naqvi and RCP Singh, today resigned from the cabinet a day before their completion of the Rajya Sabha term. President Ramnath Kovind accepted their resignations and reassigned the Minority Affairs and Steel portfolios. And now to the Maharashtra politics. Team Thackeray versus Team Shinde now moves to the Lok Sabha. The Uddhav Thackeray faction of Shiv Sena, reduced to a minority in the Maharashtra Assembly, has now appointed a new chief whip for the Lok Sabha, this fearing a revolt by party MPs. Senior party leader Sanjay Raut wrote a letter to the Lok Sabha speaker and informed him that Rajan Vichare has been appointed the chief whip and he's replacing Bhavna Gaur. The spread of the revolt among the MPs will be a huge disadvantage to the Shiv Sena, which has 19 members in the Lok Sabha and 3 in the Rajya Sabha currently. And amid a spiraling controversy about her comment on Goddess Kali being quote-unquote meat-eating and alcohol-accepting goddess, Trinamool Congress MP Mahua Moitra dared the Bharatiya Janata Party to prove her wrong. Now, this comes after her comments were criticized by the BJP and her own party distanced from these comments, saying that these are her personal views. Listen in to this exclusive conversation.
The question is that you made those remarks. You might be factually correct, but in the present context, you made it to offend. So how would you respond to that?
I did not make it to offend. The present context, I didn't. There are two. This is where the biggest problem with the media is, that you simply cannot choose what is right and what is wrong. I am a practicing Hindu. I'm a practicing Kali worshipper. There are two questions here. The question was on some poster. I didn't even answer the question. I am not even backing the poster or what has been shown in the poster. I have not seen the film. I have not seen the poster. I have not seen the film. I have not said a word about it. So anyone's talking about and putting in a headline that Mahua Moitra is defending the poster is talking rubbish, because I haven't seen the poster. And on the program, on live TV, I said nothing about it. I don't endorse it. I haven't even seen it. I am a Hindu. I am a practicing Hindu. Who is anyone to tell me whose sentiment is being hurt? In Nupur's case, they said, why Nupur, why not you? In Nupur's case, she was talking about somebody else's faith, targeting some between religions. In my case,
You're talking about your own faith. All right.
My own. The second point is this. She said it to denigrate the prophet. I said it to celebrate the goddess. This is how we celebrate the goddess. There's a very big difference. And I guarantee any FIR, anywhere, any court of the land, I ask any SHO, any IO, any justice to put down exactly how this is an offense. And I ask the BJP to put on affidavit that Kali is not worshipped like this. And I will defend this till I die.
All right. Mahua Moitra, do you feel let down by your own Trinamool Congress, who've completely distanced themselves from your remarks?
Not at all. That's between my party and me. I'm not going to make that fodder for the national press. And that's between my party and me. I'm sure that we'll sort it out at the appropriate forum.
You're optimistic about sorting this out? Because they've distanced themselves completely.
I'm a staunch soldier of the party. And I'm a staunch soldier, more importantly, of Mamata Banerjee. And I don't think there's anything happened between me and my party. And if there is, that's something I will sort out at a separate level. Certainly not on national television.
And the TMC MP Mahua Moitra now faces multiple complaints across the country, and she also faces criticism. But she says, bring it on. Here's a report.
Mahua Moitra, Trinamool MP, is facing the threat of several FIRs, particularly by BJP leaders, for her comments on Goddess Kali. MP Chief Minister Shivraj Singh Chauhan said that Moitra's remarks hurt sentiments of Hindus. The Bhopal crime branch filed a case against Mahua Moitra for deliberate and malicious acts intended to outrage religious feelings. Mahua Moitra hit back, challenging the BJP. She said she is a Kali worshipper and is not afraid of anything, and that truth does not need backup forces. which many are seeing as a dig at her own party. The Trinamool Congress was quick to distance itself from Mahua Moitra's Kali comments, saying they were her personal views.
Party does not endorse such opinion or statement, and party has condemned also.
Mahua's comments were in response to filmmaker Leena releasing a poster showing Goddess Kali smoking a cigarette. The BJP wants her arrested.
इसका खिलाफ कानूनी तरीके से कार्रवाई होना चाहिए नहीं होगा तो शांतिपूर्ण तरीके से ध्वज लेकर महाकाली जी का तस्वीर और प्रतिमा लेकर मूर्ति लेकर एजिटेशन भी होगा
On one occasion earlier, Mamata Banerjee had publicly pulled up Mahua Moitra during an administrative meeting. Now soon after the outrage over her comments on Goddess Kali, the Trinamool Congress was quick to distance itself, calling the comments her personal views and saying the party strongly condemned such comments. This has now led to speculation over her future in the party. With cameraperson GD Shankar, Saurabh Gupta, NDTV.
After three flight safety incidents yesterday, the aviation regulator has taken tough action against SpiceJet, issuing it a show cause notice and asking it to explain how it is safe. How SpiceJet is a safe airline to fly. Now, other leading airlines, including Vistara and Indigo, also had separate but unrelated safety incidents today. And my colleague Vishnu gets us the details of the show cause notice to SpiceJet, while SpiceJet CEO Ajay Singh will tell NDTV whether his airline is safe.
Lots of important, tough action against SpiceJet, in fact. With the aviation regulator issuing it a show cause notice and asking it to explain how it is a safe airline to fly. Now, as we bring you the details of that notice, that show cause notice, it is important to note that other leading airlines, including Vistara and Indigo, have had separate unrelated safety incidents today. Given the volume of air travel in India, there are approximately 30 such incidents daily. But first, details of the show cause notice to SpiceJet. Now, the regulator, in the note that you see, says that SpiceJet failed to establish safe, efficient and reliable air services. The airline continued to operate flights with degraded safety margins. In other words, higher safety standards should perhaps have been maintained. The regulator has questions on poor internal oversight in the airline and says that there are inadequate maintenance actions. What's more, most incidents are related to component failure or system-related failure, and that approved vendors who provide components are not being paid on time and that there's a shortage of spares. But in addition to three SpiceJet incidents yesterday, there were two other ones, this time involving Indigo and Vistara, and that's important. The crew of an Indigo A320 aircraft from Raipur to Indore reported smoke in the cabin during taxiing after landing, and a Vistara aircraft which landed in Delhi from Bangkok had an electrical malfunction which caused an engine snag after it landed. Now, in a statement to NDTV, the Director General of Civil Aviation, the aviation watchdog in India, has said, on an average, about 30 incidents do take place daily, which includes go-arounds, missed approaches, diversions, medical emergencies, weather issues, technical issues, bird hits, etc. Most of them have no safety implications. Well, the Civil Aviation Minister has also tweeted. Let's just take a quick look at what Jyotiraditya Scindia has actually said. He says, passenger safety is paramount. Even the smallest error hindering safety will be thoroughly investigated and course corrected. Remember, aviation is, in India, civil aviation, one of the largest anywhere in the world. And the show cause notice says that, you know, you are financially cash strapped. And this is a fact. I mean, you know, the airline is in a difficult situation. It also says that you're operating on cash and carry, and suppliers and approved vendors are not being paid on a regular basis, leading to a shortage of spares and frequent invoking of MELs or minimum equipment lists.
Again, let me say, Vishnu, we will absolutely prove to DGCA that none, of course, every airline in the world is in financial difficulty at this time. But this has absolutely no bearing, and no airline would ever compromise on safety as a consequence of that.
And now the COVID booster gap is reduced. The booster dose waiting time has been cut to 6 months from the previous waiting period of 9 months. Now, this decision comes as active cases have risen every day for the last 44 days. And currently, 1.15 lakh active cases are being reported. And this number is the highest since the end of February. Overall, 90% of India's eligible population, that is the 12-plus-year-old population, is vaccinated. But booster penetration remains low and only 5% of India's adult population is vaccinated with the booster dose. And now the gap has been reduced after the government says that science has evolved and hence the gap needed to be reduced. And Lalu Prasad Yadav is admitted in Cardio Neuro Center of AIMS Delhi. Bihar Chief Minister Nitish Kumar earlier met him when he was admitted to a hospital in Patna due to a fracture in his right shoulder. He fell down the stairs of his house in Patna on Sunday and he had to be rushed to a hospital. His condition is stable, but for better treatment, he is now shifted to the AIMS in Delhi. And now a father-daughter fighter pilot duo makes history for the Indian Air Force and they say that it's the biggest day of their life. Here's the inspiring story of an Indian Air Force father-daughter fighter pilot duo.
Flying officer Ananya Sharma kitting up in her G-suit, helmet by her side. The man next to her is her father.
Ananya always used to say, "Papa, I want to be a fighter pilot like you." And after her commissioning, when for the first time she came as Flying Officer Ananya Sharma and saluted me, I was really proud.
They are among just a handful of serving father-daughter fighter pilots anywhere in the world. In this sortie together in a Hawk jet trainer, the two would fly together in formation.
As a child, I would often ask him why women fighter pilots are not there in the Indian Air Force. And he would tell me in his characteristic style, "Don't worry, you will be one."
The father-daughter duo are a highlight in what has been a successful process of inducting women fighter pilots in the Indian Air Force. In 2018, we interviewed Flying Officer Avani Chaturvedi, the first Indian woman to fly solo in a fighter jet. She first flew MiG-21s and is now flying Sukhoi 30s.
Training, I won't say difficult, but definitely challenging. Because humans are not made to fly, right? We learn to fly. So it took approximately 1 year of flying training to become a flying officer. And even after that, it took one more year for me to come to a fighter cockpit.
India now has a woman Rafale pilot as well, Flight Lieutenant Shivangi Singh. For Flying Officer Ananya Singh, the sound of fighter jets was always inspiring.
Growing up, we were mostly always posted to fighter bases. So we would often hear the sound of jets flying over us. And knowing the fact that my father is flying one of them used to really inspire me.
And for her old man, getting a chance to fly alongside his daughter, a dream come true.
A few days back, both of us flew in the same formation on the Hawk aircraft. That was really the biggest day of my life.
The Indian Air Force prides itself as an equal opportunity force, the first among the Army, Air Force and Navy to have inducted women in a combat role. Vishnu Shaw for NDTV.
The seventh season of Coffee with Karan premieres on July 7th and right ahead of the premiere, Rohit Khilnani interviewed Karan Johar on the set of Coffee with Karan and he put him on the spot. Karan confirmed that he was not able to get the Khans for this season and he spilled the beans on whether guests on his show already know the rapid fire questions and whether the answers are edited. Listen in to this exclusive conversation.
Thank you for having me over. This is the only way I could make it this far.
Well done then.
Thank you. Right. You know, you've come a long way from season one. What has changed? Is the comfort level of doing this show changed? What has changed?
I think, you know, when I see myself in season one, I feel like there was this innocent child who was asking questions like an elocutionist, trying to be very prim and proper in my delivery and, you know, and just being very correct in my portrayal of myself.
over the seasons, I feel like there's a lot of abandon. There's a lot of unabashedness. There's a lot of ease. Like now I'm just more myself. Like I'm not bothered about how I'm looking, how I'm sitting.
Right.
Or whether my expressions are too much or whether I'm laughing too loudly or whether I'm just looking zonked at somebody saying it's just I've become just more myself.
What is that one topic that refuses to leave you?
Nepotism. I mean, it started on this sofa and that's never left me. It's never left the industry. It's never left social media by and large.
Right.
I'm still cursed for it. I'm still trolled for it. I'm still abused for it. And now I'm not bothered about
it. You're not bothered. All the stars don't easily agree. The impression a lot of people have that the minute you make call, they may jump
and they don't.
Come
so
on
many
this
people
couch.
Have said no. Like Ranbir told me, I'm not coming. And he's a really close friend of mine.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
I was like, it's fine. He's like, no, I'm not coming. Kuch gadbad ho jayega. I'll say something. He'll stay with me for life. I'm not coming. And he teases me. He says, you pay me what you're getting, then I'll come. I said, why should I pay you? I'm not paying you. I'm paying you enough of the movies you're doing. So it's fine. I said, no. And I respect that, Rohit. It doesn't mean just because they're close friends, they should come. They should come if they want to come.
Right. Do you have more episodes that you'll record? A lot of people ask me this question. Will Shah Rukh, Salman, Aamir be on it?
No, they're not coming together. I don't have that. I don't have the power to pull that trio. I can get them to a party, not
has?
On the show. I can't. I can get them to the party. That's the extent of. I can't manage two also of this three this triumvirate together.
Right.
And Bhagwant Mann, the Chief Minister of Punjab, will marry tomorrow in a small ceremony at his home in Chandigarh. Mr. Mann, who's 48 years old, will marry Dr. Gurpreet Kaur. And only family and close relatives will be present at the wedding. And Delhi Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal, the Chief of the Aam Aadmi Party, is also likely to attend the ceremony.
Chief Minister of Punjab, Mr. Bhagwant Mann, is going to tie the knot tomorrow. And one man who knows or who is handling everything, Mr. Raghav Chadha, the Raj Sabha MP from Punjab, he's joining us right now. We'll speak to him about the arrangements and whether he knew this plan in advance. So, Mr. Chadha, all excited about Veera Di wedding?
Well, it's a big day for all of us. At the outset, let me convey my best wishes to the Honorable Chief Minister Mann Saab, my elder brother Bhagwant Mann Saab, and Dr. Gurpreet Kaur, both of whom have decided to get married. And after a fairly long amount of time, an occasion that merits such happiness and celebration has come in our family. And I must congratulate Mansab's mother, Bebe Ji, Mansab's sister, and our would-be Parjai Ji. And both the groom and the bride who are about to enter into a wedlock, I must, convey my best wishes and also pray to God that both of them have a very, very happy and a blissful married life.
So we are being told that you are the one who has taken the charge of arrangement and you perhaps knew this all in advance before everybody knew. So can you just share some details of the arrangement tomorrow, where it's all happening? It's at the CM's residence or the Gurdwara?
Well, yes, I mean, of course, we knew about it. And for the last couple of days, we've been, making all the arrangements for the ceremony. It's only a small wedding function. Which will be essentially a closed door function, which will have just close family. It'll be Mansab's family, Mansab's mother, Mansab's sister, Mansab's sisters, in-laws, and a few other family members, the bride's family members. Mr. Kejriwal is coming all the way from Delhi with his family to take part in this ceremony, me and my mother. Just a handful of us will be, essentially be part of this wedding ceremony, and it's a small affair, and it may be a small affair, but it's a big reason for us to celebrate, and I am absolutely elated with joy.
So we are also being told that perhaps Dr. Gurpreet Kaur, the to-be bride, was associated with Aam Aadmi Party somewhere in campaign for Mr. Mann's campaign or something like that.
Well, I let the bride to speak to you. I'm pretty sure she'll be interacting with you at some point. Yes, she was actively participating in some of our campaigns. In fact, she had come to campaign for me in one of my elections.
It's a long association with the party.
Well, yes and no, and I will let her speak to you about this. But we are, I am personally extremely happy that she's becoming a part of our family. And I'm about to become a Devar, and she's about to become my Bhabhi. And I welcome her into the family. And all of us are super happy about this, and we're eagerly looking forward to tomorrow's celebration.
You are going to be Devar and all, but everybody's asking when you are going to follow the footsteps of your elder brother, as you mentioned in your tweet.
I know. I mean, a lot of people have been asking me, but I will let you know certainly when and where and to whom I am planning to get married. And you know, in traditional Indian families, it's the eldest in the house, in the family, who gets married first, and the younger ones follow. So once the elders are done with this, then of course the younger ones will also follow. Okay, at some
thank
point
you, thanks,
soon.
Thanks.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for this. So this was Rajya Sabha MP Mr. Raghav Chadha, who informed that the entire arrangement has been done here in Chandigarh only at his official residence. In Chandigarh, Mohammed Ghazali for NDTV.
Famous auto manufacturers MG Motors are known for their iconic cars as they step into the electric vehicle segment. MG has a special initiative for India. 1,000 fast charging stations will be set up across the country in 1,000 days to accelerate towards green mobility.
"70% of air pollution and greenhouse gases are generated due to vehicular pollution. But driving an EV or an electric vehicle can change that. These quiet electric engines produce practically no noise and certainly no carbon emissions. It's the way forward for green energy.
MG is like a first mover in electric vehicles in India. While they have launched the vehicles, MG is working very extensively on developing the charging network. What MG has come up with is a very innovative solution where it is going into the residential communities of all the major cities in India. And as a initiative from its own side, they are installing chargers in all these communities.
Often the deterrent to buying an electric vehicle is where to charge your car. But the MG Charge campaign is a step in the right direction. MG is installing community charging stations at residential colonies across India. The plan, 1,000 charging stations in 1,000 days. And the initiative has begun from Jaipur, where people at this residential colony are already charging their EVs.
I come here every evening to drop the kids for basketball. I teach dance classes here. So when I park my car here, I just put it on charging, and by the time I come back, it's gone up with the battery power, and that makes it very, very convenient.
We wanted to be the first society in the country to install these, and we have been looking forward to support the government and the initiatives to go for green energy.
And as India drives towards a greener, cleaner future, initiatives like these for the community by car manufacturers are certainly helping to accelerate the change. In Jaipur, Harsha Kumari Singh, NDTV.
That's a wrap on this show. Thank you for watching, but stay tuned to NDTV 24/7 for all your latest news.